Hi, I'm Navya. So under this pharmacology subject, I have uploaded from chapter 1 till chapter 14 in the playlist. And also, if you're not watched yet, I'll just drop a link in the description box so that you can watch it. And in this video, I'll be taking a class on chapter 15 and chapter 16. That is the drugs eliminated by dialysis, that is hemodialysis and peritoneal dialysis, and also as well the drug used during the dialysis. So let's start the class of these two chapters, that is chapter number 15 and 16, that is based on the drugs eliminated by the dialysis process. So let's start the class. So sure. The chapter 15th and the 16th. These both are related to the drugs used for the dialysis. That may be hemodialysis or the peritoneal dialysis. So let's start one by one. So first, we'll be learning about the chapter 15, that is the drugs eliminated by the dialysis. So let's continue on that. So here the basic dialysis. So this may be through the clearance of the hemodialysis. So here let us know what are the factors that to be considered during this dialysis factors. The surface of the dialysis and the dialysis membrane compositions, the dialysis flow rates and the blood flow rates. These are the factors, and mainly the two major processes there, that is through by which the drugs can be cleared during the hemodialysis. The two factors are the diffusion and the convection. So let us know the diffusion. Diffusion is nothing but it just simply the removal of the drug by the movement down its concentration of the gradient. And this diffusion is a greater with lower MW drugs, that is the less than 1000 a day. And this diffusion is also enhanced by the mixing of the concentration. So it is also enhanced about the mixing of the concentration gradient between the blood and the dialysis. That is the hemodiafiltration with a large of the ultrafiltration. This will minimize the gradient. So the mixing in the sense the hemodiafiltration as well as the ultrafiltration. Yeah. So with a minimized gradient, this may be... The diffusion may be done. Yeah, let us know some more detail. The convection is nothing but the removal of the solute by the ultrafiltration method. And also we'll know the factors that are affecting, that are affecting to the dialysability. Those are the molecular weight, protein binding and the volume of the distribution and the plasma clearance. So these are the factors that are effective for the dialysability. In the molecular weight, it all tells about the size of the structure, size of the molecular, that is a smaller molecular weight it will be the substance. So very small amount of the molecular weight substance that will be passed through the dialysis membrane one or more easily than the larger molecular weights. And there is a protein binding. Protein binding is nothing but the drugs with a very high degree of the protein. The drugs in the sense of medicine which have the high degree of the protein. So that binding will may have the small plasma concentration of the unbound drug. That may be available for the dialysis. And that makes them very poorly disabled or the acquiring multiple session. And in the volume of distribution, what happens in the drugs with a large volume of the distribution means that is usually due to the lipid solubility, and also it have very low plasma proteins, start binding very poor disability. And in the plasma clearance, although this plasma clearance may be beneficial, but still it is increasing the plasma clearance and it will decrease the dialysis clearance also. Yeah, let us know the dialysis flow rates. The common dialysable drugs are, these are the common drugs, dialysable drugs, that is the barbiturates and lithium, isoniazid, salicylates and methanol, metformin and ethanol, glycol, dipakote. These are the common dialysable drugs. So that drugs also, there will be the specification in the sense that drugs with a very low MW, that is also limited to VD, and that are the water soluble. These are the most likely to be removed by the hemodialysis and also will require the extra dosing. Some extra dosage also is required for them. So next, let us know some common medications the patients can be taken during the hemodialysis. So medication in the sense, the red blood cell stimulating agents, it comes under the medication. Why? Because the kidney help to make red blood cells in the body. So what does kidney do? It helps to make the red blood cells in the body. But when the patients are on the dialysis, it means that the patient, for them, the kidneys are not working properly, not working well enough to make that red blood cells. So for those patients, this type of medications has been used. So this will be our like darbepoetin and given once a week during the hemodialysis process, and also we have the ARIPS, that is the erythropoietin, and these are the medications to be given for the patients who are involved in the kidney disease. And this will be given for the 3 times in a week during hemodialysis. And some hemodialysis patients, they make enough red blood cells. So not for all the patients to need this type of medication. Only for those who have very less count in the red blood cell, those patients is supposed to have this type of medications. And also other medications is that vitamin B and the C. That is the replative. So vitamin C and B and C, these vitamins will be lost during the dialysis process. The multivitamin called as the replative. Why multivitamin? Because it includes B as well as C. So this is the replative. It is a multivitamin. So these vitamins, it gives both. And this replative after dialysis, it may result better way. It may result in a better way after giving this multivitamin, because those patients who are in the kidney disease, so though they may have a very so, and they will be having a very low this vitamin B and C. So for those patients, this replative multivitamins has been used. And other is as Rocaltrol, that is calcitriol. This means that, so the kidney, what does it do? It converts vitamin D to its the active form, and that helps the body to absorb the calcium. It gets a calcium from the vitamin D, and because of the kidney not working properly for some patients, so they may get into the hemodialysis through the vitamin D. Yeah, and let us know what is hemodialysis. This hemodialysis is also called as the hemodialysis or simply just like a dialysis. So this is a process of the purification of the blood of a person. For those whose kidneys are not working normally, not working well, for them, this hemodialysis process has been used. Those patients will be gone through of this hemodialysis. And this type of dialysis, what does it do? What does it the what will be the result in the sense. This type of dialysis, this achieves the extracorporeal removal of the waste products such as the creatinine and the urea, the waste products, and also free from the blood, free water from the blood when the kidneys are in the state of the kidney failure. And also this hemodialysis is one of the three renal replacement of the therapy. Three in the sense, other two will be the transplant and the peritoneal dialysis. The patients may go for the transplantation and for the peritoneal dialysis. And then there is an alternate method for the extracorporeal separation of the blood components, such as the plasma or the cells, will be appearance. And next question, that is about the explain peritoneum. So peritoneum, in the sense, this peritoneum is the serous membrane forming the lining of the abdominal activity or the colon in the amniocytes. Some invertebrates, that is the annelids. And also it covers most of the intra-abdominal. Intra-abdominal in the sense, the organs. And this is also composed of the layer of the mesothelium that is supported by the thin layer of the connecting tissue. This peritoneal dialysis, this has become the the good treatment for the modulativity for the end stage of the renal disease. For the end stage of the renal disease, this treatment has been become a popular, and this treatment has been given for those type of the patients. And the introduction of the continuous ambulatory peritoneal disease dialysis further popularized this technique. And also we have the another question, that is a mention the appropriate drug dosing in the patients receiving the peritoneal dialysis. So this is for the patients of the peritoneal dialysis patients. So what are the drugs has been used for them? So the here, the quantity of the drugs removed during the peritoneal dialysis, so that have very low, and during the hemodialysis also. And also the efficiently removed drugs during the hemodialysis, this is not necessary for the patients, that is CAPD. And also we have the disadvantage of the disadvantages. So let's move the disadvantages here. The major disadvantages is it is very risk. The infection, it is will be the high risk, and also the patients may gain weight easily, and very large people may need for the extra therapy and also need ample storage space in the home to supply this peritoneal medications. Yeah, let's move to another chapter. That is the drugs used during dialysis. So here we are going to discuss what are the drugs, what are the medicines that is used during the dialysis process. So in this question 16A, it is that what are the common drugs prescribed for the dialysis patients? These are the drugs, these are the medicines to be taken for the dialysis patients. So here, the people with the kidney disease, patients or the people who are suffering with the kidney disease, so those definitely be very active in participating precautions and some medical presentation. So these type of activities they will be participating. Why? In the sense, to understand the medicines to be taken from the doctor or from the medication board. So here we have some prescriptions. It has to be taken to those dialysis patients. Let us know that medicine. Some prescriptions. Azathioprine. So this is a medication. So all patients who are in the end stage of the renal disease, end stage of the renal disease, or the patients who are on the dialysis may have anemia. So this anemia occurs when the person has the very low RBC, that is red blood cell count. So those patients may take this, and also this kidney, what does this kidney do? It makes and to segregate the hormone. So that hormone is called as the erythropoietin hormone. So erythropoietin, this is nothing but the hormone. So that is responsible for making the normal RBC, because RBC will be very low for those patients who are suffering in the renal disease. So this medication, so this is the hormone, it increase or it makes RBC in a normal state. It makes RBC in the normal state. RBC count, cell count, RBC cell count maybe, may it become a normal. And the kidneys are responsible for making and segregating this hormone. So the kidneys are very responsible for this. And next is the iron. It is very essential that in RBC, the iron content must be there. So in order for erythropoietin to work well, iron needs to be presented in the RBC. That is what iron needs to be present in the RBC. So without iron fever, the red blood cells are made and it will be very smaller in the size and it will be not capable. It will be not able to carry much oxygen. So if the iron is very less in the red blood cell count, means it will be not able to carry much oxygen, and very small amount of RBC cells with the iron, other than that or the leads during the hemodialysis session. And here we have vitamin D. So people with chronic kidney disease, people with the chronic kidney disease, and those are on the dialysis, they can experience the loss of the bone minerals. So this bone minerals loss, in the sense that includes calcium and the phosphorus. Loss of calcium and the phosphorus here. Phosphorus. So this calcium and phosphorus, they can also mix together to get hard. They can mix together to get hard and to build in the small blood vessels of the feet, intestines and the heart. And this condition can lead to amputations and abdominal pain also it results in. And these complications are due to the mix of the dietary calcium. Why? Because these complications has been facing in the sense is the mixing of the dietary calcium and phosphorus. Vitamin D and hormone that is called as a PTH. PTH in the sense parathyroid hormone. Parathyroid hormone. And here we have phosphorus binders. Phosphorus binders in the sense, when the parathyroid hormone level, it raises, then definitely there will be an inflammation in the bones. Including this, the calcium and phosphorus will be lost from the bones and it may move into the bloodstream. Because of this kidney failure, the kidney cannot longer get rid of the extra phosphorus. So that's in the blood. So this dialysis, what does it? This dialysis do? It removes only the little bit of the phosphorus, not completely, just a little bit. And preventing or reversing this process can be done through the dieting and the medication, such as phosphorus binders. By this medication, it can be done better. And other is a B complex vitamin and folic acid. Folic acid, where is that? Yeah. So here, B complex vitamin and the folic acid. So here, the dialysis procedure, this removes the extra amount of water. Usually, dialysis, it removes extra amount of water that soluble vitamins such as the vitamin C and B complex vitamin and the folic acid. So while kidney diet can usually keep up with those losses, and many people on the dialysis don't always have the appetite, and also the topical creams and antihistamines, and also many dialysis patients have very itching problem and the dry skin problem. These are the problems they may face during the dialysis. Yes, and also we have a concept of vitamin E. Also, we have it. So, why? The itching problem they may face, and in vitamin C, E. So, this has been said to help many people as a preventative measure for the cramps. This is the preventative measures for the cramps when taken either before dialysis or at the bedtime. When the patients take this on the during the dialysis or to the bedtime. So this completes the concept of 15th and the 16th of the drugs used for the hemodialysis or to the dialysis purpose.